I want to introduce you all to a friend of mine. I just we've met online, and we've been getting along famously. And his name is Professor Robert Belcher, and he is an archaeologist and a CEO of Expeditions and Research Applied Anthropology. I can't take that call. I'd like to, but I can't.
Are you able to unmute him?
No, I can't, unfortunately, Mama Afua. I'd like to.
Where did he go? I don't see him anymore.
Well, he's here. He's here. He's actually here twice. He's here as Robert, and he's here as Professor Robert Belcher.
Okay.
The sound is not coming through for some reason. Robert, I don't see you on mute on one of your sessions. Oh, it says connecting to audio. Hold on. This will not be on the YouTube video. None of this that we've covered. We won't.
Okay, we can cut all this out.
Bob Marley, the Warriors, or any of that.
Good.
Okay, we just. But I want to say, Robert, when I was talking to him, Professor Belcher, he's the youngest of the Bennu study group. He takes great pride in being the youngest of the Bennu study group. And what is that? And that is a collection of African scholars and students who are interested in critical thinking in relation to the African in world history. And he was part of that group. For those of you that are familiar with the subject, he's part of that group that brought Dr. Shenkata Jope to the United States. So he's part of that group, you know, with Asa Hilliard and others bringing him to the United States. And so I had some questions I was going to ask him. If he can connect, that would be good. Hey, Darnisha, glad you can make it with us too. So I see on his second connection, it says connecting to the audio. Okay, Robert, are you there? Yeah, we're still having issues. But I want to share this PowerPoint that I made. Can give you, he's sort of here, and maybe we'll hear him. He actually is a real person. It's not somebody I made up. As a matter of fact, he called me from Egypt one morning. And I asked him I said, bring me back a galabeah, and he did. And let me stand up here and show you. It's hard to get a galabeah for me, because guys, let's see. This is what the brothers wear in Kemet.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We'll have to get us some over here.
You hear that, Robert? We'll need to get some. And he has a family that has kind of adopted him in Luxor. And actually, he looks like them. He really looks like them, as a matter of fact. Okay, so I want to share this.
Okay. And we in there?
Everyone as well. So he disconnected the second one or puts it on mute. That.
Yeah, I'm trying to mute that one.
He doesn't have a mute container on this one. There's no way to mute that second one.
Okay, is that better?
Okay, better.
Yeah.
Okay, can anybody hear me?
Yes. Okay. Let me play one of the things that Robert wanted me to do.
I'm here.
Okay. One thing that Robert wanted me
to do. Y'all see me?
Yes, yes.
Okay, great. All right, so I'm here.
This second thing, though, I can't mute it for some reason, you know. So, Robert. Okay.
What in the world?
Yeah.
I'm trying to remove that one, but I hope it won't cause him some.
Was it the comb thing? Don't worry about it. Let's just talk.
Okay. So Robert, okay. How did you get started being interested in Africa? You were a chemistry pre-med major at Morehouse, and what changed your direction?
I was in a class. It was a history professor there. He's still there. His name's Kleinbord. And for some reason, I had to take a test. He didn't want us to leave the room. So he said, do you have a book or anything you want to read while you're sitting there? Because he didn't want us out because he thought we was going to go tell our classmates. So anyway, I pulled out The Destruction of Black Civilization. He looks at the cover. It's a picture of an African with a spear and an Asiatic man on a horse. And he goes, this book's anti-Semitic. I didn't even know what anti-Semitic meant. I'm looking at him, and I said, what are you talking about? And he says, look at this cover. And I said, wait a minute. I said, all it's saying is the ancient Egyptians were black and African. Well, that's not true. And of course, being a scientist and being into science, numbers, and facts, I couldn't reconcile that. And so I confronted him about it, and it escalated to me relying on Asa Hilliard to tell me some things. And we went back and forth for about 2 weeks. And one day, I just got tired of his mess. And I went in there with a picture of me standing next to my science project and a picture of me as a 7-year-old boy and a picture of Tutankhamun, death mask, and him coming out of the Lotus. And I slammed him on his desk. And I said, tell me to my face that these two individuals are not from the same racial group. I didn't have the capacity to explain that any better than race, because that's some BS too. But anyway, he said, I'll admit to you, Mr. Belcher, that if he lived in the United States in 1940, he'd be, he'd have to ride in the back of the bus. I said, that's all I need to know. So he says to me before I walk out of the room, would you like to use the racist criteria of the United States to define humans? And I said, I'll get back with you. The next day I came in, I said, yes. And that was it. That's how we got started. He created a monster. Because after that, I ended up reading there, you know? So that was what it was. But I'm done.
Okay, you know, Robert, your connection when you speak, it's still not clear. Let me go through the PowerPoint and show that movie that you want me to show. But you stay there, okay?
I'm not going nowhere, man.
All right, cool. All right. All right. So here is the PowerPoint. That's what we're going to talk about, Afro picks and combs. And so this video is about 17 minutes, 14 minutes, something like that. But this is what Robert is talking about, his Afro comb exhibition.
Is it on video?
Here we go.
Okay, this exhibit is called 6,000 Years of Culture, 600 Years of Chaos. And the reason why I did this was because I wanted to give a visual explanation for why hair is so important in the African community, African American community, and African community worldwide. And I say worldwide, even Area 6, which is the African population outside of the African continent. This is a picture of me when I was about 18. That's when I first started doing collecting. I was about 18. I'm in Egypt. That's Dr. John Henry Clark. That's a Dr. Asa Grant Hilliard. This is me. I'm about 20 in this picture. And that's Dr. Sheikh Anta Jop. And he was a Senegalese Egyptologist and one of the first people to get my attention on this subject matter. That's that obsession thing that they had about me. They had in rapemyprofessor.com. Okay. This is a small picture out of his book, The African Origin of Civilization. This is a Tutsi man, and this is Ramesses II, an image of Ramesses II. Okay. These headrests are from all over Africa and also China, because anywhere you find populations that have elaborate hairdos, they want to protect them. And this is one of the ways you protect your hairdo when you're asleep. Put it at the rest of the neck and you sleep without moving. This can be a real personal issue with some people about touching their hair. This is a headrest from the tomb of Tutankhamun. He had about 50 of these. This is the god of the horizon, Rereti. This is the god Shu holding up the sky. This is Tutankhamun's mother. Her name was Kiya, K-I-Y-A. This gentleman is the 11th dynasty, and that's called an afro. This poem here came out of a book on Egyptian hair. I think it's very important. This young lady, this image, is of Akhenaten's daughter. He has six. I don't know which one this is.
Meritaten? I don't know how you pronounce it.
Meritaten. Yeah. If they don't have a name on them, like the bust of Nefertiti, if they don't have a name on them, we can't say with absolute certainty that that's who that is. All of his daughters had that elongated head. This elongated head is found amongst the main Bedu people in South Central Africa. There are elements of that down on this end as well. This is a weave or wig. This is from ancient Egypt. This is a wig. This is a wig. And you see these same wigs in Atlanta, in New York, Philadelphia. When Chris Rock did his show Good Hair, I looked at it and I was thinking to myself, nothing's changed. These are pre-dynastic combs. Let me go back to this comb here. This comb here is made of wood. It's 18th dynasty. And it has two different sizes of teeth. The smaller size, the larger size is used to comb out the hair. The smaller size is used to you with gel, and then you wrap the hair around and then you turn it in order to get it to lock. This does not mean that these people had two different textures, two different populations, and that this hair, this was a tool used to lock hair. And this is a modern example of it. Right here. This is this little plastic one right here. The reason why I'm pointing that out is that some people have seen this and they thought that because the teeth were in different positions and possibly the hair texture had changed, there was a function to the width of the teeth. And one was to pull the hair out, and then the other is to use it to turn in order to lock it with some type of gel, like fat or oil. This comb is from Morocco.
this comb is from Ethiopia, that's from Ethiopia, and that's from Ghana. One of the professors that I knew when I was working at Emory, she said she didn't know how to connect the cultures of Africa, so that's why they have an Egyptian gallery and an African gallery. And this is how you connect it. You connect it through cultural artifacts. What's the word for artifact? What's the word I use? Vernacular word. Stuff. You connect it through people's stuff. Okay, let's put it in here. Why is this to be so important that we put the images on our stamps? And these stamps are from Africa. Every particular place you can imagine.
These stamps are from Africa.
We've got Egypt. We've got Rwanda. All over. I could run out of wall space when looking for things like this. These combs are from all over Africa. This is from Kenya. These two pins are from Kenya. This is from this actually is a Kofoibwe comb. This comb is Baule. I have a Baule student, so I asked her a question. I said, what is your word for comb? And she didn't know. Then I had an Ivorian student, and I asked her, and she said, our word is blah, bra. And I said, okay, so I go back when I get a word from a culture, and then I go back and I see if I can find it, its analog in an older culture. The word for hair in Wolof, which is a West African culture, and the word for hair in ancient Egyptian is the same word. Again, connective tissue. This particular image also comes from Sheikh Anta Diop's book, and it says prepubescent girl, and then there was a statement in it that said the whole course of human history would be changed had black girls had long hair. And while that sounds a little strange, what he was basically trying to say was this: woolly hair is different from straight hair, and woolly hair is not, it is attractive, but in terms of a female aesthetic, a lot of females feel that longer hair is more attractive than woolly hair. So how do you deal with hair? You lock it and you braid it. And later on, we do things like relax it. And being a guy, I didn't know this, but there's an actual difference between relaxing and perming. It's supposed to be diametrically opposite. When things are not a part of your world, you can't figure it out. So, I mean, for me, with all the hair I have, I never made the corollary. Here are the devices that are used to protect these elaborate hairdos. You know, again, it's a guy thing. I was in class one day, and my student was standing in the class, and she was doing this, and I was saying, you okay? And she said, yes. And I'm like, well, why are you striking yourself? And she says, I don't want to mess my hair up. I said, oh. I said, so you can't? She said, oh, no. And I was like, okay. So I had to do some inquiries. So I said, what's the deal? She says, I spent $500 getting my hair braided. And she said, if I start scratching it, you know, she says, I'm going to lose my money. So this is, when you see somebody doing this, they have not lost their mind. They're trying to keep their money. Okay. This is a headrest from ancient Egypt. It is Old Kingdom. This is Queen Hatshepsut. This is Khufu's mother. This is Senwosret's wife. This is Khufu is the builder of the Great Pyramid. These are from all over Africa. This one is Sudanese. And actually, this is part of a tree. This is a natural, this this was minimally carved. This is part of a tree, and these would have been branches, and they just carved the back so that he can rest his neck.
In fact, why I talk about it when I can show you. Here's a gentleman. This is a man from Turkana. He's using the headrest. This lady is Mangbetu. Just like that princess in the earlier shot with the elongated head, long-headedness is considered an attractive feature. And when they don't have people with long heads, they will actually wrap their heads to get longer heads.
So, just, could I interject something here? Which when we were installing all these and putting them together, and I specifically asked you why these Turkana headrests had handles on them when none of the others did.
They carry those headrests with them. The Oromo and the ones in Turkana, they have sticks that they keep with them, and they also carry those with them. They carry their pillow with them like you carry your wallet or your purse, because they never know when they want to take a nap or sleep, and what are you not going to do? You're not going to mess up their hair, especially when it takes you 3 months. A hairstyle like this is very elaborate and takes a long time to do.
And you were telling me they were herders, so they're always moving.
They're always moving.
With their herds.
Yeah, always moving. I'm glad you pointed that out. I forgot.
See, well, I found that very interesting because I was looking at one of my sketchbooks from back when I was a student many years ago, and I had drawn from museum collections. I'd drawn a bunch of headrests because I've always found most of them were ancient Egyptian, but I found the form very interesting as a sculptor, and I'd never seen any with handles on them.
The sedentary cultures would not put a headrest, put a handle on the headrest. Like, for example, the Egyptian one made of, the one that back over there was made of ivory. That was from Tutankhamun's tomb. He had some made of glass, blue faience. Well, those would have been in a room. They would never have actually probably ever left the physical structure, but these guys are running all over the place. These are the guys who were picking up the coffee beans that we were talking about earlier. These would have been walking, they walked miles. I mean, in a day, they might walk 20 miles. Nomadic population.
Plus, if you're on the ground in this environment, things crawling in your hair.
Exactly, you've got to protect that. Let's go over here for a minute. I organized these combs here to, you know, represent what parts of Africa they come from. Ghana, Morocco. This is a picture of a pre-dynastic Egyptian comb. That one there, that one's from Ethiopia. This one's from Uganda. This one's from Kenya, and this is Zulu. That one's Zulu. This one is pre-dynastic. This lady right here is Queen Tai. This is Tutankhamun's grandmother. This is Akhenaten's mother. This is Nefertiti's mother-in-law. We always talk about Nefertiti. We very seldom talk about her mother-in-law. And she was Egyptian. She was not Nubian, she was Egyptian. Egyptians look like this. And Egyptians look like other people. Just because they're dark doesn't mean they're not Egyptians. And I'm pointing it out because one of the things people will say, they'll say, well, this is Queen Tai, and Queen Tai clearly, because she's dark, she's Nubian. No, that was a very normal color because they used all ranges of color to depict themselves. Let's go this way.
Since you're talking about how they depict themselves, Can you tell us why in most of the tomb paintings of ancient Egypt, the men are always depicted with dark reddish skin and the women are depicted with much lighter skin?
Much lighter. I don't know about much lighter, but I'll say this. Red ochre is used to depict males. It has something to do with the god Horus. It has something to do with regeneration and power. The color yellow is associated with things like sunlight. I have pictures that I didn't put up of Queen Kawit, who is Mentuhotep II's queen, and she is coal black. Those colors, according to Dr. Sheikh Antijab, were ceremonial. I can show you images of the same pharaoh in browns, reds, and I can show you images of queens also in lighter colors. I'm not saying, first of all, Africans come in a whole bunch of shades, okay? And so when I make these declarations about color, Africans went through a change in America. It used to be a time people would make comments about people's shade. I'm talking about black people amongst ourselves. And the 60s and 70s brought a new change. So we stopped talking about dark skin, light skin. We could talk about what we were attracted to, but we don't make public declarations anymore about somebody being less attracted because they're dark or light. In fact, it completely flipped. I'll tell you a funny story. When I was in Egypt in 86. When I was in Egypt in 86, I ran into a young lady, and she was from New York, and she was very dark, and she had beautiful braids. And the guys who were in Nubia, they said, oh, we give you the sister price and all this. They were really, really, they were hitting on her. And one guy, he brought her a beautiful scarab, and he tried to give it to her. And he was really just seeing how far he could get. And so he said, my beautiful Nubian princess. And this was about after the 100th time she had been called that. And she snapped on him. She said, I don't understand this yet. She said, when I was a little girl, I was all kinds of nappy-headed little black bitches. And now I'm a beautiful Nubian princess. Y'all need to make up your mind. Okay. She was very angry because things had flipped, you know, and she became from being an object of scorn to something of great beauty. You see what I'm saying? And see, that's part of this thing, the schizophrenia. That's why the name of this shark show is 6,000 years of culture, 600 years of chaos. Because when we go through all these pictures are from West Africa. These are West African barbershop pictures. This is a hot comb. I would have killed when I was 12 or 13 to get a big old bushy afro like that. Because I was real happy. There was two things I wanted. Big platform shoes and a big old afro like that. And so, you know, but that same big old afro you see here is the same big old afro you see on the other side of that wall where that Egyptian princess is, you know. So this is my thing. I don't understand when I run into Egyptologists why they don't make this natural connection. Once this natural connection is made, maybe the people like myself, who they want to call rabbit Afrocentrists, maybe once that connection is made, we'll shut up. Because the obvious will have been stated. The young lady who hollered about being a beautiful Nubian princess and then flipped, her problem was, she always knew she was beautiful. She didn't need any reinforcement. All she needed was an acknowledgement, and then just move on. You follow? Okay. This is a comb with Muhammad Ali on it. You'd be surprised how much stuff he's endorsed over time. Someone asked me, where do I get my stuff from? I get it from everywhere. I go anywhere. I've gotten so obsessed that I can't pass by a beauty shop without going in there looking for a Afro pick. And I've been doing this particular Afro pick thing for about 4 years, back and forth looking for different ones. I got this from a pawn shop in Atlanta in East Point. And the guy, I was debating, because I have a limited budget. And I wanted it so bad. And he said, look, man, he said, I'm going out of business. And he said, you better buy it. He says, because you'll never find another signature of his that's that straight. And I know, I said the irony of that statement, because of the disease that he has now, I jumped on it, you know. Let's go here. And when I talk about the chaos, this is the chaos. This comb here is called a bone comb. And I, and by the way, made in Korea, made in China. These don't look like those African combs. These are made of plastic. The cyst in and of itself might harken back to a much further, much more ancient time where that particular thing is called a power salute. This is a picture of a priest from ancient Egypt. This is Anubis. This is a 21st dynasty image, okay? But what I'm trying to say is that little bone there, if you look in the original casing, they have this young lady and she's got a straight hairstyle and then the bone in her head looking like pebbles from the Flintstones, you know? So this was not, I don't think this was meant to be flattering, you know? And everybody keeps showing, when I put it in there, I wasn't trying to say, ooh, this is something I'm proud of. I mean, I was basically saying, look how far and how crazy this has gotten. And then if you look at the bottom end, she's got the comb in her hand and she's using it like a weapon. You know, she's holding it like a weapon. And this guy is dressed up like a businessman. He's got that comb stuck in his pocket, in his lapel, like we would have our handkerchief, you know. So who controls your image? The persons that control your image control you. A friend of mine used to say, he who defines you confines you. Okay, so let's go here. This is another West African barbershop painting. They're very popular. In fact, I've gotten to the point now I see these same or very similar images. I know they look like they might have come from some part of New York or Atlanta or some other urban city, but it's urban like Lagos, Nigeria, or somewhere like that. So even 4 or 10,000 miles away, people use the same implements to do their hair. In Japan, African American culture has become extremely popular. So popular that Japanese people are getting afros, okay? And this is actually, they have a culture, they call it hoochie culture. And they are getting tans and they're wearing hip hop clothes and they're dressing like African Americans. I suggest you just YouTube it. This headdress is from Papua New Guinea. Papua New Guinea is a part of Oceania. And this is a headdress that these gentlemen, who also have woolly hair, are demonstrating. These are Huli wig men. And they spend years collecting their hair and say that making these particular wigs. You're not a man unless you have a wig in their culture. And they have, one guy, he got in trouble with his tribe and he is considered persona non grata because he doesn't have a wig. He has 4 wigs, but he can't retrieve them because of family dispute. But this is part of that. This guy here is from Fiji. This guy's from Papua New Guinea. Let's go back over here for a second. This guy's from Fiji. That guy right there is Sai Baba. That guy is a Wadabi, North African. They call them the people of the taboo. And right, and they claim to be migrants from Nile Valley culture. In fact, their beds look identical to ancient Egyptian beds. They're fluted at the end like a lotus. this guy here is Little Richard, and he's doing that same primping right here. So I believe in the
I'm going to end that show, and thank you, Robert. That's I hope I didn't end it too soon for you.
No, that's good. You got a lot of information out, man.
All right. Okay, I'm gonna go ahead with the PowerPoint because I have some of the things that you have in there. I was really interested. Well, I'll just say I used to read a lot of Satya Sai Baba, and you had Sai Baba's picture there. He has a giant fro and yeah.
People all don't right. understand. India, Herodotus said there were two types of Ethiopians. There was the Asiatic Ethiopian and the Continental Ethiopian. And that the only difference between the two was the texture of the hair. And remember this, Hindu Kush, that's in India. That is not in Africa. And they have words, they have cognates that match up. There is a deity that's in India that's also found in East Africa. And I mean, the storylines are the same. If you get a chance, start studying Campbell, this guy, Robert Campbell, the mythologist. Man, the truth is out there. We just got to look for it. It's there. Sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah, our brother that's on now, Brother Damani, he's into Joseph Campbell. Yes, The Power of Myth. It's a great work. Let me get back here and try to share some things as time moves on. Let's see. So yeah, there you were, and
yeah.
So when we're searching, we can look for Afro Comb exhibition by Professor Robert L. Belcher. So if you're looking on YouTube and you want to see that, that's what you would do to search for it.
Yeah. Now check this out.
What's that?
I had to get it. I was on eBay. I had to get it. My family thinks I'm crazy.
No, I didn't see it. Can you put it? Can you show it again? Oh wow! Wow! Wow!
Yeah, and I'm glad I bought it when I did, because when I looked again, I found that the other price was in excess of $1,000, and I got mine for under $100. You told me what somebody was happy. Yeah. Okay. Wow,
that's wonderful. That's a good catch. And for somebody that's geeked out on that like you are, I just that's priceless. All right, I'm gonna get back.
Here. I want y'all to pray for me.
All right. So these are some of the things that Robert had and other things. So here is your exhibit that was there on the video. I find this one here really interesting because this is a mummy. And you know, your hair continues to grow even after you the spirit has left the body. And here this mummy is still growing her locks. And here's
oh yeah.
And here's a brother, he's got his fro.
Yeah, that his name is My Hair Perry. And the guy on the other side, the one you just showed on that other side,
yes,
is Masaharta. Yeah, Masaharta.
Masaharta.
And Masaharta. Mm. And the gentleman with his arms in that position.
Yes.
My Hair Petty. Yeah.
I mean, he just looks like somebody I used to play basketball against at Castlemont High School. You know, just.
Mm-hmm. Like, oh yeah, and don't forget, there's a Ethiopian dance the Ethiopian women do with their hair, and it's called Iskarta. And they sling their hair around. Yeah.
You know, and I've seen that. I've seen that.
Yeah, it's beautiful when they do that. I love that.
Seen that.
Maybe whipping it.
And this picture, yeah, it shows. So it's showing Kemishan women at the top and Ethiopian at the bottom. You know, they're still rocking these styles. You know, they haven't gone anywhere. And here in this lower corner, they're at the shop. They're getting their hair done.
There you go.
Yeah.
Yeah, working it.
And then here's your Fijian. Look at that comb. He gets his fro combed out. You know. And then this little boy. They just showed something with that little boy. He's grown up now, but he wanted.
Oh wow.
He wanted to touch Obama's hair because his hair was like his. And they're in the Oval Office.
Would you please send it a link to I want to see what he looks like now, that little boy.
Okay. You have to.
I almost cried when I saw that picture, man.
Yeah.
I really did. It made me almost cry, seriously. And the part that made me really like it was he's wearing red and black tie, which are the colors of a Legba.
Wow. Wow.
Yeah. Wow. And a Legba is a child.
Mm.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. That's deep. I like that.
Now here is Brother Robert. And you know, he's led an exciting life. Now, when you talk about the study group that you were with, is this the group? Because I wasn't sure.
That's it. Okay. To the far right is Dr. Finch.
Yeah.
The lady, her name's Soraya. Mm-hmm. The other lady was a person that was working with Dr. Finch. I can't think of her name right now, but she was working at Morehouse School of Medicine. Of course, that's Asa Hilliard. Mm-hmm. The gentleman in the center is Dr. Charles B. Colfer. He's the first black man in the United States to receive a PhD in Old Testament studies. He got it from the University of Chicago. They did not want him in there. He came in kicking butt. And until the day he died, he was the foremost expert on black people and personalities in the Bible. The woman next to him is Charlene Harper Brown. The gentleman next to her is, Obadiah Williams. That's me behind Obadiah. And then, I'm blocking on the name. See, this is what happens when you get old. I'm starting to get old. His name's gonna come to me before it's over with. Doctor. Oh my God. It's gonna come to me. Don't leave me. We good.
Okay. Let's go. All right. And then here you are this is kind of like your elbow, I think.
That's me in the corner.
Asa and Joe. Doctor,
yes, that was at the Morehouse. That's in the chapel at Morehouse College. That's Dr. That's the Morehouse Chapel on Morehouse campus. And what you're seeing there is our little private meeting. You see everybody got their little munchies in front of them. And we were basically having like a private meeting and where we were asking him questions before his meeting the day after when he presented to the whole school. By the way, they carried him brought him to the United States. They carried him to Howard University to introduce him. The people at Howard tried to convince him to lecture before he lectured at Morehouse. Well, we had paid money to get him on the fly. He said, I am not going to disrespect my people at Morehouse by super. Then they could say, we had him first. You had him first because he landed there first, but he was ours. You know, but I guess that's proprietary. Sorry about that.
No, that's some good eyestery on that. That's some good. And so for those of you that don't know who Dr. Shekhata Jope is, most famously in this book in the center on the bottom, African Origin of Civilization, Myth or Reality. This was his PhD thesis. It took him twice to get his PhD. And he went with Dr. Obenga and they took a truckload of books to prove the African origin of civilization. He also came out with this book, and Dr. Hilliard used to love to talk about this, the cultural unity of Black Africa. This is a really good book. Cultural unity, all of them are really good. Cultural unity of Black Africa, showing the continuity of African culture throughout all the continent. Let's see, somebody put something in the chat. Let's see. Oh, all right. Thank you, Mama Darnisha. Okay, and then Civilization or Barbarism, another classic work. This book here, Black Africa, the Economic and Cultural Basis for a Federal State, he shows how to create a United States of Africa in this book. And then Dr. Van Sertima immortalized him in this work, Great African Thinkers, in his Journal of African Civilization. So that's just a little bit on Shake Out the Joke. Hey, Robert, you want to add something on that?
You know, sometimes I look at these things and kind of laughing because I'm in that book because of Obadiah Williams. Obadiah when you take the oral and you turn it into written, he sat for days, listened to every word of his speech and put it in written form so that we would have that book. Obadiah Williams did a Herculean task. He created that book and he worked with Dr. Van Sertima and, you know, of all the scholars I've known, he was the most dedicated to Black people. And he had a fantastic library. He had a beautiful, fantastic library. It looks as good as Sister Tony's library. If you were to multiply it by about six, that's how many books. I mean, he had at least two rooms dedicated to books. And it was like crazy. I mean, it was like, and the only other person that had a bigger library that I could imagine, well, I went in his house. It was Dr. Kofor. Dr. Kofor's entire basement was covered from wall to wall. And then in the center, he had bookcases. And he had them front to back. He literally had a library in his basement. He didn't have a man cave. He had a library. So I love Black people with book libraries because that tells me so much.
Yes, indeed. Yeah. Yes, indeed. All right. And here you are with the scholars. So here you are. Is he autographing your book here?
He autographed that book. I got to find it. It's somewhere in my house. Uh-huh. And this time when I find it, I'm going to wrap it in gold. I'm going to stick it somewhere. And then I'm going to get me another copy and just use that one. But I've got three or four copies, but that's the only one that's autographed. And I got to locate it. But it's in my house. It is definitely in my house. That's when you know you got a bunch of books. When you know how many you got, but you can't find them all because you had to get an extra one.
Oh, yeah.
It happens. Yeah.
I'm there. Now, here you are with Dr. Obinga. Where are you? Where are you?
We were at Morehouse School of Medicine. He was actually, I had my chenoos on and I had some words on it. He was reading my chenoos. And one now, of the words.
Why don't you explain to people what a chenoo is? Why don't you?
Okay, the French people went over there and they saw something and they said it looked like something they had. So they said cartouche. Well, cartouche is a French word. The African name is a chenou. The word sheen, S-H-E-N, means to protect. And the word for name is ren. So you put your ren inside of your chenou. So when it's round, like you'll see in Tutankhamun's tomb, you'll see an eagle with these two round circles lined up under it. They're carrying this protective symbol. But when you put the name in it, it's sympathetic magic. It's voodoo, okay? So you put your name inside of you protecting yourself. You get me? So that's what it is. It's a chenou. And that's the other reason why we know they're African. They're doing African stuff. You can't be no more African when you're writing on everything. You got spells to protect your stuff. Oh, man.
Yeah. Now here you are with, thank you for that, Chenou. You know, today they call those sigils. If you look up the word sigil, I think it's spelled S-I-G-I-L. Those are sigils. They call them today in modern times.
I have a friend who's white, mm-hmm. who tells me this, and writes on his own skin. And he talks about sigils, including tattoos. This is how I feel about it. If Africans did it and they named it, I'm going to use the African name.
Yes, yes.
And I'm not going to revert to something some white person came up with, because it ain't got nothing to do with me.
Mm-hmm.
Look, we the mama and we the daddies. We got to stop copying our children.
All right. Now, here you are with Dr. Obinga and Dr. Hillier.
Now, that is at Pat Sigil's office. You know, she is
That's Dr. Hillier's wife.
Yeah, that's her office. When, what was his name? Mario Beatty, who is an expert scribe. Mario Beatty is with ASCAC. He was working on his dissertation, and he had to give a lecture. And Dr. Obinga had gotten off the plane. Mario was there, and we went to Asa's house, and then we stopped at his wife's place. But we were carrying Dr. Obinga to lecture to see Mario's presentation to defend for his PhD. So that was the day Mario defended for his PhD.
Wow. Wow.
Yeah, that was a good time.
Wow.
You know what's funny?
What's that?
When I saw him and we were at the airport, I grabbed his bags and I lifted him up and I was toting him. He didn't even ask me, okay? And Mario was standing there, and I think Mario picked up something, but I grabbed him real quick. And he looked over and he said, "You see, this is what you're supposed to do with your elders." He was chiding Mario, because you know we gotta protect and respect our elders.
Yes,
I don't know where in the world I was gonna let that man tote his bags. He just got off the airplane. You know, we gotta look. We gotta man up and woman up. When they come in the room, stand up, bow, do ballet, do whatever you're supposed to, but show them that respect while they're alive. Don't be bragging about them when they're dead. Do it while they're alive.
True. Now here, this looks, I would say this, you're in Kemet when
these. Yeah, you found two of them pictures. I had to crop that brother out in the corner. He was, what do you call that, picture diving in the corner behind Asa?
What do they call it? I can't think of what it is.
There's a name for it. They creep behind your picture.
Photobomb.
Yeah. And so that's another picture of me when I was in Egypt with Asa. Well, what happened when we came to the United States, I got my head wrapped in Nubia. I was in Nubia and we were at the Cataract Hotel. We're at that same hotel you see me and Dr. Clark and Asa in. And we were there, and I only had a kufi on, and the man said, "You need a wrap." And I said, "What?" He said, "He needs a wrap." Next thing you know, he said something in Arabic. I'm sitting there eating some, trying to eat my scrambled eggs. They're wrapping my head. And the Asa said, "Robert, do you know what's happening to you?" I said, "No." I said, "It feels good." He said, "You're being crowned in Nubia." I said, "What?" It was fun. It was good.
Well, hey, I mean, that's what I'm saying, man. You've led an exciting life to hang out with these guys. Now here, this is a video. It's about 2 minutes that Professor Belcher, Robert Belcher, made. It's dedicated to the great scholar, Asa Hillier.
Thank you. quest that's just begun. When you're feeling real alone, yeah, there's a great truth that you should know. When you're young, if feeling right, your soul in act.
You to talk about that. So what are you saying? What are you explaining in that video?
Well, that was Asa's PowerPoint, and he gave it to me. He said, will you do something with it? I said, yeah, I'll do something with it, and I turned it into the video. So if you want to look for that, go on YouTube and type in loving memory of my friend and mentor Dr. Asa Hilliard. Now I'm going to show you something. If you look in that video, you saw a yellow piece of paper with some writing on it.
Yes.
Asa went and gave a lecture. Okay. One of the teachers, who I believe was black, might not have been, because Asa worked with everybody. He said, I was teaching my students your material. My students clept out of all of their stuff. They were advanced in his class, so that they didn't even have to take some of the other courses. So the next semester, the principal took him out of the classroom so he wouldn't be teaching them like that no more, and gave him another course because he was threatened by the fact that the kids had learned twice as much or three times as much as they should have. So read the letter, that little yellow letter. Because that little letter, he slid that to Asa, and Asa kept it. Asa would keep stuff like that. He would hold on to stuff like that because he wanted other people to know that when you start performing, when you start teaching, one of the things that happens is the never grows, some people say Negroes, never grows, will do whatever they can to stop you from showing your greatness, hiding your light under a bushel basket. By the way, when you watch that video, copy those references. Those books are diamonds. Those books are platinum, gold, precious. Yeah, look at, read this. She says, African studies, talking about Kemet, this coming year. And he said, they took me out of the class and it stuck me in another. But it's all in that letter. It's amazing. It is amazing. You know, that was a gift. As a small gift. Yeah.
And here you are. Yeah. Now, what do they call that rap there?
It's just called, you know, I don't know the Nubian name. So the next time I see you, I'm going to call Ashraf and tell him what they call it. But all the Nubians, the real Nubian men, they wrap their head like that. Okay. So that's Baba Ali. His daddy was the first family that lived on that street across from the Colossus of Memnon, Amenhotep III. Their family, he had four sons. and the land was divided amongst the four sons. So now he has cousins on either side, but the house in the center that faces it, he's the youngest. That man is the youngest of Mr. Ali's children. And so my buddy and my adopted family, those people, they are the first family to live on that street. And by the way, half the people in Lux are related to each other. They know each other. They're either cousins. It's like going to school in Atlanta. We had Howard, we had Turner, and we had David T. Howard, Turner, and Washington High. Well, if you're black, you had to go to those high schools. So everybody either knew each other or they were cousins. And so that's kind of what happened in Luxor. These people know each other. And by the way, when you go there, it's like being in New York or Atlanta. You be looking around, you saying, wait a minute, now how did you get over here? They look just like us. And even the ones that don't look like us, you go in the house, and guess who cooking? The grandmama. And she looked like your grandmama, black. Don't let nobody tell you those people are anything else but black folk. And they play a New Orleans game because you see the yellow ones in public, and the darker ones will be doing other stuff. It's a game. It's a game. I'm done with that. Oh wow. Okay.
Yeah. Oh yeah. So that's me back in the day with my mom.
Wow. I see you. And, you had a serious afro. Working at Lenny Kravitz hair.
yeah. And here's some brothers on the continent, you know, rocking the fro.
Rocking that fro.
Here they are, and you know, Questlove. He's
Where is that?
Where's this one?
Okay. Yeah, what is that? Is it two colors? His hair is two toned.
Is that New Guinea? Some black people, their hair is two-tone. So their hair is
black. That is Oceania. He is Solomon Islander. A Solomon Islander. They are blonde. Some of them are natural blondes.
Yep. And this brother looked like he's got a modern comb in his fro. And
he got that fist. Yeah. He got the fist.
Yeah,
he's Ethiopian. I think he's either Ethiopian or Somali.
I think so. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that gun. I love to see. You know, the only thing look better than a black man with a gun.
What's that?
A black woman.
Oh yeah.
I love to see black women holding guns. I would make it mandatory for every black woman to have a gun and know how to shoot it. I'm serious.
Yeah.
All right.
And I found this picture. This picture used to be like, I first saw it in Ebony magazine, and it was like in the 70s. And this is a young brother, you know, and he smooths his fro out with butter. And
then when they get older, they
cut it. And this may be his father, I don't know. And here you can see,
in they're the doing the same thing.
People are fixing, you know, he's at the shop fixing, and here they're doing it like you were describing
earlier. When the British came over, they didn't call them by the correct name. They used to call those people fuzzy wuzzies.
Yes,
that was what their name was. But these people are from the Dinka tribe, and other tribes is another name for them. It's escaping my memory, but these are East Africans in the area of Ethiopia.
Abidja?
Baga.
Is that how it's pronounced? Yeah. Okay, Baga. Okay.
Yes. And the British Kitchener and all them said fuzzy wuzzies. See, we got to stop that crap. We really do. We need to put them in check every time they do that. But anyway, I'm done.
No, I like this one here. This picture.
Yes.
This is out of Sex and Race by J.A. Rogers, Volume 1.
Mm-hmm. And you know that she had the elongated hair here. Yeah. You know,
she's a princess from Rwanda.
Yes.
But I like the captions underneath, and you probably can't see it, but it says the Ethiopians have pronounced Semitic features. Kinky hair, thick lips, but otherwise not Negroid?
Okay, now, anthropology professor, I gotta let him loose.
All right.
Semitic is a language classification. And the Semitic language is African. They say Afro-Asiatic, it's African. The oldest Semitic language is Oromo, and it's out of Ethiopia. It is the mother of all Semitic languages. Now, how do we know that? Because it has the largest number of cognates. Cognates mean words. When you have a mother tongue, it has all the words. And then the daughter languages will have half or a third or something less. Now, the other way you know that the language is related is because certain words follow a pattern. The mother tongue will have in it the words for mother, father, brother, sister. You will be able to trace those. Also body parts, hand, feet, tongue, genitalia, all that. That's how you know which language is the mother language. So now, Mr. Kanye or Ye and whatever, all you know, they gonna call him anti-Semitic. He's not anti-Arab. What he is, he said something against a. That was the one I wanted to see. Oh Lord have mercy. That's a good picture. I like that one. The Wasim was red next to the African on the other side, the other African. Yeah, that's beautiful. So I want us to put people in check when they use the term anti-Semitic and say, well, is he anti-Arab? Is he anti-Somali? Is he anti-Arab, Somali? Is he anti-Hebrew? Because all of those languages are Semitic. How do they get to pick and choose what is... They should say what they say. He's anti-Jewish. Okay, but he ain't anti-Semitic. That's a language classification. Oh man, you did a good job on that one. That's your son?
No, that's somebody else. No, that's not my son. No.
Oh, okay. Oh, by the way, down in the middle one.
Yes.
That's Hesse. That's Hesse Ray. He's the world's first dentist.
Oh, you know what? I got him a little bit later. Let's see. I have him on here. Let's see. He's coming up.
But you know who Hesse Ray looks like, right?
There he is.
Okay. You know who Hesse Ray looks like?
Who?
He looks like Frederick Douglass. Mm. Get a picture of Frederick Douglass and put it in. He looks like Hesse Ray, the world's first dentist, looks like Frederick Douglass. Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So the guy to the left is Mihir Petty. Mm-hmm. Mihir Petty. And then Hesse Ray. And that's another classical of Egyptian. I believe that's Middle Kingdom. And the gentleman in the white, he's Ethiopian. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All right. You know, they even had Wave for the Babes back in ancient Kemet, too. Hello? Oh, Robert, did you
leave? Some chat.
Oh, okay.
Call right. For some stuff like that.
Okay. All right. Let me go back.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Ways for the Babes.
Oh hell yes. Oh yeah. Sorry.
Yeah. Hey. Thanks. I'm
good. Okay. Yeah. I know.
All right.
Lord have mercy. Look at that.
Yeah.
I will tell you a funny story if you want to hear this one.
Okay.
All right. So Asa was in the Cairo Museum, the old Cairo Museum, and there were the three sisters standing around him and they were protecting him. And I said, what's going on? He was walking through the museum talking to these sisters, telling them what they were looking at. You're not allowed to walk in that museum and talk to your own family members. You have to hire an Egyptian to tell you what you're looking at. Whoa. So they'll get $10. Yeah. So he said, Robert, don't say nothing. Cause he knew I'm, I can be volatile. He said, Robert, don't say nothing. He said, they almost arrested me. He said, these three sisters surrounded me because he was telling them what they were looking at. And he was not paid by the government to tell the story. So we were walking through there and they walked past some wigs, 4 foot long dreadlock wigs in the basement. Okay. Ptolemaic period. And the guy says, the tour guy, he goes, these wigs are made of wool. And I stood there and I said, bullshit. And Asa grabbed me, he said, Robert, stop it. Seriously. And then later on, he said, look, Robert, he said, even if the wigs were made of wool, whose hair do you think they were trying to imitate? But it was our hair. It was like your hair, brother. Imhotep, yeah. It was your hair.
Well, like this kid here on the right.
Oh, Lord. Yeah, that's butter.
Yeah.
That's butter.
And then, you know, in the ancient times, that's what they're depicting. Yeah.
Same thing.
Yeah. All right. We've come to an end.
I'm sorry.
Do
we have time for anybody to ask any questions?
Yeah, we do have time for questions. So go ahead if you want to ask. Please raise your hand in the in the way that we do on Zoom, and so we can do it kind of orderly. If you have a question for Professor Belcher, go ahead, Sister Judy.
Well, greetings, Professor Belcher. How are you?
Hey, I am good. How are you?
I'm doing well. We enjoyed your presentation, and I wanted to tell you, I went to Spelman. What years were you at Spelman? I mean, at Morehouse.
I was at Morehouse from
right?
I live on the house. I play in the yard.
Right.
Yeah, okay. Sorry about that. That's a little inside joke. By the way, those two schools have the highest intermarrying rate in the country. Morehouse men marry Spelman women higher rate than any two colleges in the country. Well, anyway, from 1978 to 82.
Okay, I had Christine Ferris, King's sister, Martin Luther King's sister, is my reading teacher.
And she was nobody to play with.
I know.
That's a series.
I ended up going to Tuskegee. That's where I'm from.
Okay.
Spelman. But I was going to ask you, did you go to Asa Hilliard's memorial service at King's?
I was there.
That was awesome. That was a 2-day event, and I only went on the first day, but it was beyond spectacular.
You were there during the opening of the mount ceremony?
Yes.
That they did?
Okay. Oh, my God. That was really good. But thank you. That is my comments.
Yeah. Oh, that's beautiful. Yeah, I was there.
All right. You know, my friend that I was telling you about, Dr. Kofi Kondwani, he was there too, and he did something on stage. I don't know if it was Pour Libation or something. Anyway, any other questions or comments for Professor Belcher? You guys are a really lively bunch. I guess we answered all the questions already. Go ahead, Sugar D. It looks like you're going. Are you going to say something? No. All right. Well, you have to unmute.
I know. I thought it was so funny when he did the one about the hitting of the head. I just thought I was going to just die. I cracked up because that was just a familiar thing. He just said, they're not crazy. They just don't want to mess up their hair. But
it's real.
I know.
It's real. And that whole thing about, my daddy used to run a nightclub, and these guys would want to dance with the girls who had spent a whole lot of money on their hair. And a lot of these guys were like drug boys. And so one guy, he said he wanted to dance with this girl. And she said, oh, no, I'm going to sweat. I'm going to mess my hair up. He said he had a wad of money. He said, girl, I'll get your hair done. Come on, let's dance. Seriously, that hair thing is serious with us. We are serious about the hair. which is why when we don't do the hair, we'll do a gele or we'll do a wrap, because we got to keep. Oh yeah, when I'm teaching anthro, I'll say, this is show you the intelligence test. I'll say, touch the kitchen, and every black person in there will do this. And then the white people be sitting around looking silly because they don't know where the kitchen is. And then I'll say, the occipital plate is the kitchen. And then I explain it to them. Because, see, they want to always use their stuff.
Oh, Robert, we're losing you, man. We're losing you. I hope you come back. Look, Kat, why don't you answer your question? Brother Katabasi, why don't you ask your question? And maybe Robert will hear it and can come back.
So when you know what somebody knows, you can find out what they don't know. So they've been using their little game on us. Let me tell you what happened to me when I was trying to get in grad school. I told one guy, I said, look, I don't do well on standardized tests. It was a Jewish man. You know what he told me? He said, well, if you did real well on a standardized test that comes from Princeton, New Jersey, all it would prove is that you're Jewish. I said, what? Now, this is what he said to me. So don't accuse me of being anti-Semitic, okay? He said, this test is designed for a certain group of people to succeed. Know your enemy and know what they know. Yeah, this deep. I don't know how I got there. Anyway.
Go ahead, Professor. Katabasi.
Thank you. Thank you, Minister. Professor Belcher, have you ever slept on one of those headrests?
Yes. Yes. I need medication. I'm not on any medication, but I need medication. Yes. I had to. And yes, they are uncomfortable. You have to really want your hair to be in proper position.
That's what I suspected. They're beautiful.
Don't tell nobody.
Beautifully sculptured and everything, but boy, they just didn't look that comfortable.
Well, it teaches you discipline, because when you lay in there, you know, you learn. Yeah. Something just happened. The screen got bigger.
No, I put you in the spotlight, which I should have had you all this time. All right. Any other questions before we conclude? Sorry for the connection, but the information was priceless. And let's see, was there another hand? The information was, okay, yes, Sister Judy, go ahead.
Yes, I was gonna ask you, Professor Belcher, I'm sorry, I missed some of the beginning. So where are you now? Where are you located?
I'm in Atlanta. I have retired, well, my health, I'm a kidney transplant patient. Okay. And I don't have to worry about grading nobody's papers no more. And I think the ancestors decided that they wanted to use me in a better fashion. So now I am going to be retired. I'm going to be hustling for myself. I ain't got to worry about no department chairs telling no lies, stealing my work or nothing like that. So that's my deal.
Okay. Well, I was wondering, that was my next question. Had you lived in Atlanta for any period of time? I live in Atlanta, so...
I am indigenous. I was born at Fort McPherson. Not only was I born in Atlanta, my mama and my grandparents, most of my grandparents were. So I am a native. I went to Harper High School.
Okay. Yeah. I know some people that went to Harper.
Wow. Yeah.
Well, it's nice.
Well, they know me if they were there from 73 to 78, they know me.
Wow.
They do.
You know Kanzi Johnson?
That name sounds familiar. I probably need to see a face. What year? It depends on what year.
Okay.
For me, I was the little nerd boy that was always being called out on the intercom. And so a lot of people just, oh, I don't want Robert Belcher made he won another science project stuff, and I was like, oh God. I was kind of loved and hated at the same time because I was a nerd.
Okay.
You know. Yeah, yeah.
Well, so anyway. All right, well,
thank you.
Well, no problem. Our time is concluded. I'm sorry about the connection, but again, the information was priceless. I want to thank Professor Robert Belcher, my new best friend, for coming on, and thank you for this great Galabeya. He said he had a hard time partnering.
He leaves in that one. That's one of the best ones. He's got a picture. I got a picture of me standing next to the statue of Memnon in that thing. And he said that's my Galabeya you got on. I said, oh God.
One more thing. Do you know Kenneth Zaki?
Hell yeah. I mean, yes. That's my boy.
I was
going to say,
I know you know Ken when I thought about it. Yeah.
Kenneth is, I'm going to say he's my spiritual brother. You know, I mean, he actually is 1 year behind me. Okay. But from Morehouse. He went to Morehouse.
I just talked to him today.
He's doing well. I'm glad his health is better. He's going to be moving around pretty soon. I hope he gets his prosthetic.
Okay. All right. Hey, thank you. Mama Darnisha, thank you for putting the things in the chat. If you guys want to save the chat, there's some good information in there. And we're certainly going to ask Professor Belcher to come back because he has so much knowledge. And he's even talking about coming to the Bay Area to look at the Ramses exhibit in San Francisco. So we'll be able to see him then. All right, well, I wanna thank anybody. Is there anything else that we need to be thinking about, talking about, or doing something about before we leave? Thank you, Sister Tony liked it, and Kalahari. Next week, who's on the agenda? Next week is going to be, it's not, oh, is that the one that Common's on, Mama Darnisha? And she just walked away. Well, we're going to have another great one tomorrow, because it's a whole bunch. We're just giving you the hits. You know, we're trying to give you the best information we can. And this will be ready in a couple of days on YouTube. And Robert, I'll share it with you. And
don't forget Dr. Charles Finch.
Dr. Charles.
Oh yeah,
Dr. Charles Finch is going to be on November 10th. That's a Thursday. That's going to be a special one. We're going to have Dr. Charles Finch on. So make it a date and don't be late. See you next time, Uncle Job Saneb. Life, prosperity, and in health. Live up.
All right.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Oh, okay. Okay. Let's check this out before we go. Here we are. That's next week. Casual.
All right.
We'll be on talking about the Medu Netcher next week. Thank you. Thank you, Mama Nagina. Right. Yep.
Peace.
All right. Take care.
Thank you, Professor Belcher. Great presentation.
Yeah. All right now.
All right. Live up.
Live up. Peace.
Peace and blessings.
Yes.
Asante sana.
Kwaheri, or Tutananana. Let me just say, I'll see you later. Tutananana. Mm-hmm.